fire. Give you reason, take you higher. See the champion, take the field now. Unify us, make us feel proud. In the streets, our heads are lifting. As we lose our inhibition, celebration, it surrounds us. Every nation, all around us, singing forever young. Singing songs underneath the sun. Let's rejoice in the beautiful game. And together at the end of the day, we all sing. When I get older, I will be stronger. They'll call me freedom, just like a waving flag. When I get older, I will be stronger. They'll call me freedom, just like a waving flag. So wave your flag, now 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 wave your flag. surrounds us. Every nation all around us.
Sing forever young, singing songs underneath the sun. Let's rejoice in the beautiful game, and together at the end of the day, we all say,
when I get older, I will be stronger. They'll call me freedom, just like a waving flag.
Rejoice in the beautiful game, and together at the end of the day,
we all say.
When I get older, I will be stronger. They'll call me freedom, just like a waving flag. When I get older, I will be stronger. They'll call me freedom, just like a waving flag. So wave your flag, now 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 wave your flag.
Good morning and warm welcome on behalf of the Department of English, Kamraj College, Self-Finance Tutorial. We have all attended many seminars and this pandemic situation has brought us to the New Year concept webinars where we stay relaxed in our own place and gain knowledge. As a matter of fact, we as academicians have devoted much of our time and space to the webinars conducted during this pandemic situation, which has to widen our knowledge in the arena of English literature. I hope today's webinar on post-colonial studies and neoliberal globalization would also be a wide range of inputs to our knowledge. We are delighted to welcome you all for the webinar, and I request Dr. P. Shashikala, Assistant Professor of English, to deliver the welcome speech. Over to you, ma'am.
A very good day to one and all. A warm and cheerful welcome to everyone who have remembered and taken efforts to stay connected with us today for the second day of the two-day international webinar, The Postcolonial Perspective. I greet all the early birds who have managed to connect with us through Zoom. I welcome all the beloved audience who are with us through YouTube. The Department of English Self-Financing Course, Kamaraj College, Thoothukudi, is more than happy to play host to people who have gathered here online from many countries around the world. We are sure that Dr. Masood Raja will give us nothing less of a wonderful session today. Truly, it's a blessing to have him with us, for we are about to learn so much. The connection we share with people from different parts of the world through our shared love and respect for English literature is something gorgeous. Let this event take a mark in history, and may we part with knowledge, contentment, and delight. Thank you.
Thank you, Shashikala ma'am. Indeed, it's a great honor to have with us a wonderful resource person who is keen in enriching our knowledge. And I request Ms. Anuradha, Assistant Professor, to introduce the resource person, Dr. Masood Ashraf Raja, to the participants. Over to you, ma'am.
Good evening to all. Thank you for joining us
Warm greetings to all. It is a great honor for me to introduce today's speaker, Dr. Masood Ashraf Raja, Pakistani writer, critic, poet, and novelist. He is an associate professor of postcolonial literature and theory, Department of English, University of Texas, the United States of America. He has earned his doctorate in postcolonial studies from Florida State University in 2006. His areas of specialization are postcolonial studies, globalization theory, and the study of Islamic cultures and politics. He is an accomplished writer with several published works to his credit. The Eastern Breeze in 1999, Once Upon a Country, a novel in 2002, Constructing Pakistan, Foundational Text and the Rise of Muslim National Identity, 1857 to 1947 in 2010. The Post-National Fantasy, Nationalism, Cosmopolitics, and Science Fiction in 2011. Critical Pedagogy and the Global Literature, Worldly Teaching in 2013. The Religious Right and the Talibanization of America in 2016. ISIS, Ideology, Symbolics, and Counter-Narratives in 2019 are some of the major works that he has published. Dr. Raja is currently working on his next book titled Democratic Criticism, Poetics of Incitement and the Muslim Sacred. He has published extensively in his area of study and on general academic topics in various academic journals and anthologies. He is the editor of Pakistaniyat, a journal of Pakistan studies. He is a member of PMLA Advisory Committee, the premier journal of literature and language, and has been elected as the executive committee of South Asian Group Modern Language Association. Moreover, he is the director of a partnership program between University of North Texas and the National University of Modern Languages, Islamabad. Today, we are privileged to listen to Dr. Masood Ashraf Raja, who is amidst us. Like the Cattleya twins, where the second flower is getting ready to join its sister, our TIA participants are ready to bloom by our words of expertise. On behalf of all, I welcome you, sir.
Thank you so much for inviting me. And I would like to especially thank Professor Prem for reaching out to me. Now, first of all, can you all hear me okay? Just let me know if you can't. So, and thank you so much for such a wonderful introduction. I'm delighted to be able to speak to you. And roughly the way I will try to conduct this is to give a brief conversation about my understanding of globalization and how it relates to postcolonial studies. And then I would hope you'll have some questions and we can then have a conversation. But at any time, if you lose me, if you can't hear me, just please let me know. Or if you can hear me, even then, just let me know so that I'm sure that I'm not speaking in air. So I'll start with my understanding of globalization. Now, on the American academic left, when we speak of globalization, what we are basically talking about is neoliberalism and the neoliberal aspects of globalization. And I've heard a lot of people use the term in their writings, in their conference papers, but they never really unpack it. And I always feel the need to slightly unpack the term itself. So in, let's say, in economic theory, when we say neoliberalism, what we actually mean is not necessarily that it's some kind of liberal ideology. It's actually very conservative. But the reason we call it neoliberalism or neoliberal globalization is because the main people who believe in this kind of ideology are retrieving from the works of mainly from Adam Smith. And Adam Smith was considered a liberal economist because he, in his huge book, Wealth of Nations, suggested that the economy would do better if there was less state interference, right? And he's the one who famously used the word, the hidden hand of the market will guide, you know, the economy. So the reason we call Milton Friedman and others neoliberal economists is because they are drawing from certain assumptions. Let me unmute myself. So that's our understanding of it. So what are the basic assumptions of neoliberal economics? It relies on a certain specific theorization of the human subjectivity itself, right? So it assumes that we are all rational beings. Two, it assumes that we all seek our answers. If given a chance to explore our potential, we will explore it to the maximum. And against these individual, collective, and individual drives, what impedes our progress, according to neoliberalism, is the state regulation. So the logic is, if we deregulate and let individuals seek their self-interest, we will create a society of self-interest seekers, and thus everyone's standard of life will go up. That's the basic assumption in neoliberalism. And I'm not going to go into the philosophical detail of it about how does it come from Hobbes and through John Locke and later, but I can answer a question when you want it. Now, within that then, if you look at post-1970s American economy in 1977, Nixon delinks the dollar from the gold standard. And when he does that, he connects it to the potential of US economy. Then second thing that he does is he allows large businesses to move money freely from one part of the world to other without paying any fines or anything. Now these two steps coupled with what the World Trade Organization has done make the global economy speculative. Speculative in a sense that if I have extra $1 million, I can float them in the global market and they can go and capture the high interest rates and the high exchange rates and come back to me having accrued more money. So if you have wealth, you will make more money. So this is roughly our very basic understanding of neoliberalism. And then, you know, where you go and study the global economic institutions like IMF, you know, World Trade Organization, World Bank, what's their role in the developing world? Look at the third world or developing world debt. And all of that knowledge then enables us, the humanists, to see this world in which we live, not necessarily detached from the realities of the world or detached from the global realities of the world. But what we learn through the works of scholars who criticize neoliberalism, that while immense wealth is being produced in the world, right, people are getting richer and richer, poverty has also increased. Insecurity has also increased. Instances of terrorism and fundamentalisms of all kinds has also increased. Now, since 1970s, post-1980s, most global economies had to buy into this model of economics. And as a result, they had to privatize a lot of state functions, right? It has happened in India, it has happened in Pakistan, of course, in the United States. And because of that, state lost one particular aspect of its legitimizing strategies, and that is, you know, its legitimation through good works, through welfare projects, through taking care of its own people. And increasingly, as the state cannot do that, it cannot promise people we'll give you food, we'll give you health care. What it does is it promises them things that it can do. We'll build the strongest army in the world. We will be a powerful nation. And then the politics within these nations becomes factionalized, right? Because power is also privatized. When the government can't take care of you, you will go to someone in your region who has the power to create some kind of a safety net, create some kinds of jobs. So violence is also privatized. Now, can all of you hear me, or Am I speaking in air? Just raise your hand so that I know. Okay, thank you. Thank you, Nida. Okay, so this is like roughly, I'm just summing up like a huge theory and then practice of how global economy works. Now, what do we do as post-colonialism scholars? Now, I mean, you know, we come from so many different places. Some of us are pure culturists, some of culturalists, some of us are Marxists. I accidentally ended up being into globalization field because I chose globalization and cosmopolitanism as one of my sub areas of study for my PhD. So I realized that what it enables me to do in my classes is to put my class structure, whatever I teach, in the larger superstructure of global economy, and then teach my texts accordingly. And then on a smaller scale, when you're handling a novel, when you're dealing with a novel, you can also look into it and see what kind of human subjects are being represented there, right? And are they ipso facto the products of the world in which we live in, or are they driving against the grain of mainstream economic system? Are they dependent on it? Do they succeed in it? Do they fail in it? What it enables you to do is to incorporate in your understanding of a novel or a story that so many of the things that happen to us or that we do ourselves probably are caused by things larger than us. And our idea of who we are is also structured through those experiences. So I'll give you one example, a novel that I teach, which is Ngugi Thiong'o's Devil on the Cross, right? Which is an earlier novel, but it is a novel that critiques the global economic system, actually stages a whole scene in which the investors from the developing world or former colonies are there to hear the pitches of the local rich people. And in the process, it also tells the story of the failure of the promise of the nation state, which is Kenya, but that failure is simply not because people are not hardworking enough or the state has no resources. The failure is based in the strings that are attached to the former colonial powers still and how they function within the nation state in affiliation with the local elite, right? Who instead of, you know, building their own nation, of course, are seeking their own self-interest elsewhere and so many times do at the cost of their own people. And so a knowledge of how global economy works enables us to understand that better. Another novel comes from Africa, right? And that is Bushi Emeshita's Joys of Motherhood, right? So we could read it, we could read Noego's life as an individual tragic character, right, who lives a hard life and then dies alone, or we could read it as a life lived under colonialism in the urban part of where the system created by the colonizers was a ruthless system. It had no safety net. And since she's so far away from her own community, she has no access to whatever that community would have provided her. So that way it becomes the life of a neoliberal human subject, poor, right, deracinated, not in contact with her original culture, living in a culture which has no space for her or doesn't create a safety net for her. So that's how this knowledge enables us to read. Another example of a novel that you can read differently with a little bit of knowledge of how globalization or how neoliberalism works is Rohinton Mistry's A Fine Balance, right? Which is a novel about India, right? And in that too, you can see Ms. Dalal's struggle, right? First of all, her own dream of seeking her, there is a certain economism involved there, right? She doesn't decide to, you know, go and join a women's collective. She doesn't decide to go and you know, get a job. She decides to free herself through entrepreneurship, right? Which is one of the human subjectivity that we are encouraged to create in this system. And her failure then isn't necessarily her own failure. Her failure is because there is no safety net for her to fall back on. So that's why the novel is called A Fine Balance. Like the moment that balance is disturbed, that's how precarious her life is. But if you look at the neoliberal system, that's how precarious our lives are. Like we are usually just one accident away from ruin, right? One tragedy away from losing whatever we have, because we can't go and say, you know, I lost my job, now take care of me, state, because you promised me that. That promise has already been foreclosed to us, right? And it allows us to read a novel and understand the plight of a character, but then also in my classes, what I encourage is, you know, how to take this knowledge and look at the world in which we live, look at the poverty that exists in it, and then ask ourselves, you know, is this the kind of world we want, right? And the only way then we can sustain this system is by, while the global economy is open, you know, commodities can move freely, capital can move freely. The only part of a productive process that cannot move freely is labor, right? They need visas, they need permissions, right? Because if we can keep them fixed in their place, we can exploit them. And so precarity then, having a precarious job, then becomes not just an outcome of this system, it's its necessary precondition. In order for them, for businesses to succeed and be profitable, they have to have workers whom they can exploit, workers who have less rights, workers whose rights have already been given up by their local governments or by their federal governments in order to get more investment, and workers who are fixed in place who cannot move. So if you look at Mr. Trump's strategies right now, whatever he's trying to do to keep his base stable with him is all these policies, which are destructive policies in terms of human life and suffering. But that's what his people want to hear, that we'll not let anyone come in. These people are coming and taking our, you might have heard it in your state or in largely in India. So these are some of the things that neoliberalism and the knowledge of globalization and how it works can enable us to read literary texts differently. And I think to read them in a way that we can relate the text to our own lives and the lives of our students. But beyond that, maybe with this knowledge, our writing would change. So, sorry, for a moment, I keep losing the internet. So you might have noticed, like, the reason it's happening probably is because we live in a small village and our internet is wireless internet. So maybe because of that. So these are some of my ideas. Based in that, then, how do I teach, let's say, my classes, since you all are from a college, I think that's really important. Sometimes my undergraduates, especially, sometimes they are perplexed because they ask me sometimes, is this a macroeconomics class or a literature class? Because the way I teach them is in the beginning of a class, depending on its level, if it's a higher level class, I give them a primer on how the world works. And within that, how the global economy works, what is exploitation, right? What is wealth concentration? What is the income gap, right? What is Taylorism? What is post-Fordist system, right? How does the conveyor belt change how the workers are used and helped? The role of, offshore companies, how are those workers exploited? And then what it does is for them as students, it places them where they are, right? And it makes them aware of their own privileged location in the world. because my hope is to encourage them to become more empathetic human beings, especially about their local others and their global others. And so then we go into the literary texts. And of course, I choose my own literary texts, so they are kind of synchronized with the theme of the course. But the entire course then becomes this understanding of the world in which we live, the social world, the political world, but most importantly, also the economic world, which in so many ways overdetermines our lives. And then we go to the literary texts and talk about them and talk about, you know, how the characters in them, where could they have come from, right? How can you have someone, you know, such as Waringa, right, in The Devil in the Cross, right? She's the female character. If you look at her life when the novel starts, she is that precarious female worker in a big city in Nairobi, right? She has internalized the logic of colonial identity, colonial mythologies about how our hair ought to look, the color of our skin. She uses all those creams and she has no volition. She's exploited. And then by the end of the novel, she has become this independent, strong woman, right? We don't know what will happen to her, but we know she is no longer a victim. And that she does that not simply in that neoliberal model of going back to the family, that culturalist model where we show a character goes back to their family to, no, she does that through solidarity with others, with other workers, other people of her class. So then what the novel teaches us, how do we sustain life in this world in which we can't rely on government to take care of us, where family structures are no longer sustained, is through solidarities with others from our own class, maybe from the group where we live. And that's what that novel teaches us. So that's the kind of journey we take in my classes, you know, from learning a little bit of globalization, learning a little bit of postcolonial theory, and then applying it to the literary text. So looks like I've been talking for quite some time. I hope I'm not boring you all. So at this point, if you have any questions, you can ask them or you can put them in the chat and I will see if I can. So I'll just conclude my talk. So overall, a general knowledge of globalization, how neoliberalism works, can enable you to teach literature more effectively, can enable you to help your students understand their own lived conditions better. And maybe by doing so, they can then actually become transformative people in the world. And even if they go and join the machine of capital, of course, all of us have to do that, that their approach to it would be different. They will question its assumptions, right? And that's what I try to do in my classes. But roughly, that's generally how you can infuse postcolonial studies with the knowledge of macroeconomics and globalization. And now, if you have any questions, okay, so I have one greeting from Agra College. Thank you so much. Okay. So no questions yet.
Thank you, sir, for this wonderful session. Now I call upon Dr. P.
Shishigala. So I'm here, so if those of you who can hear me or on camera, you can feel free to pose a question.
Yes, sir, audible.
Sir, definitely. There are so many waiting to pose their questions. I'm Dr. Shashikala here. We request the Zoom participants to raise their hands in case they have any questions to ask Dr. Raja.
Yeah, I can hear you a little bit.
A little bit, sir. Am I not audible? Hello, sir. Hello, sir. Am I audible? Sir, am I audible enough? Sir, you need to unmute yourself.
Yes, I can hear you now.
Okay, sir. We have some people from Zoom ready to ask you questions, sir. Can I ask them to ask you questions right now?
I did that.
Yeah. They'll be asking you questions directly, sir. May I ask Mr. Shafkat Mushtaq, kindly unmute yourself and you can post your question.
Yes, absolutely.
Mr. Mushtaq? Maybe the person has raised the hand unknowingly. I'm not sure.
Or if if you could post it in chat too, that way, if I can't hear you, I can
yes, sir, definitely. We have Ms. Nida Amrin. Kindly unmute yourself and post your question, please.
Hello. Hello, am I audible?
Yes, Nida, you could proceed.
Good morning, ma'am, and good morning, respected Masood, sir. I'm very honored to listen to you today because I have been your student on an online platform. So I just want to ask you this question. I do not know whether I am sounding silly or something. I would like to know the role of travel literature, role and connection of travel literature with globalization and neoliberalism. Could you please throw some light on this? I mean, relation to travel literature, this colonialism, globalization and travel literature. Hello?
Okay. That's a very interesting question. Okay, so I mean, think of the travel literature, like travel film. I always, laugh with my wife. You know, you've seen those American movies where, her lover is leaving and the guy runs at the last moment and buys a ticket and surprises her in the plane. And I laugh with my wife. I was like, that will never happen to me when I was in Pakistan. We could never make a movie like that. In India, we could never make a movie like that because all the movie would be, she has left and then you're standing outside the US embassy, you're applying for the visa, then you have a visa interview. The entire movie will be, what does it take for you to get to the United States? So travel literature, I mean, part of it is that you have to have the power and financial resources to travel. Then you have to come from one of those countries that has the passport that permits you to move wherever you go, right? So in so many ways, travel literature, if you look at the colonial travel literature, it was about the power of the colonial powers. I mean, that famous essay, Rani of Simur, where Spivak, theorizes the whole concept of wording and cathartation, right? That is that the British officer can walk across the Indian landscape, right? And in the process of doing that, make the native servant see his own country from the point of view of the master, right? So travel literature in a way, in that sense, is a typically, genre of the powerful travels. Now, of course, there is a tradition, a parallel tradition like Bharti Mukherjee and others who have also told the stories of traveling from our parts of the world to the metropolitan, right? Tayyab Saleh's famous novel, The Season of Traveling, Moving to the North, or whatever it.
Hello? Hello. So please unmute yourself.
When the people from former colonies or current developed world write a travel narrative, it's, you know, eat, love, and whatever that movie was, right? There is no question of access. They can go anywhere they want. The only question is, am I going to be safe over there? If not, can we have a character who's a local guide who takes it upon herself or himself to protect me, the European self? While the reverse travel genre is usually of a struggle, right? You're either escaping something or the West is the place of freedom. So there is an inherent inequality in the travel genre, I would say. I don't know if that answers your question or if you got the gist of what I was saying, but that inequality is, it already overwrites the kind of stories we can tell. And
thank you so much, sir.
Let's see the chat.
Thank you.
Explain eclectic bibliography in post-colonial. That's a really interesting question. Okay, Santosh, right? What people mean by eclectic bibliography is, okay, so why do we post-colonialists, we tend to be eclectic? Because we use, I mean, we are in that famous term, we use bricolage, right? We are not looking for the ideal tools to open the text because that would commit you to one theory or one school of thought. I'm a Marxist, I'm a deconstructionist. If you have an eclectic approach, then what all you need is the tool that is useful at a moment. The project needs to be the same, right? My project is to dismantle the discourses of power, wherever does it exist in terms of gender, sexuality, race, region, ethnicity. That's my project, right? The tools come and go, right? Sometimes I'll use Marx, sometimes I'll use Franco Berardi, sometimes I'll be a culturalist and use Homi Bhabha, right? Sometimes I'll use Spivak, right? So that eclecticism does is it enables you to look at texts and write about them from different perspectives, but also it doesn't commit you to one school. It doesn't, you don't owe your loyalties to one school of thought or one scholar, right? Which kind of bothers my, you know, Marxist friends, because I was like, yeah, I'm a Marxist, I'm a compositional Marxist, but I don't owe anything to anyone. You know, I'll take Marxist thought where it is useful for my work and I'll use it, but then I'll have no problem using Foucault and Derrida in a different work. Because the idea is you're not looking for the ideal tool. You're just looking for something that can open that can that you're trying to open. And I think that kind of eclecticism helps you. It keeps you independent. It keeps you free of these pulls of an affiliative structure that Edward Said would call it, which becomes very stringent and becomes affiliative. That's from The World, The Text, The Critic. I highly recommend that book. So that was Santosh, your question. I wanted to know what is the role of social media and other forms in spreading globalization. Okay, so that's Debian Das. Yeah, the really good question. Connection keeps going out. So social media, okay, so it has a huge role, especially in spreading a certain kind of culture in the world, right? So whether it's good or bad, I mean, so like everything else, every new technology, it depends on the use. On the one hand, social media can put us in touch with people all over the world, wherever they have some access to the internet, right? Or a phone.
So we have a question from a YouTube viewer. The question is, from Ms. Nirupama Sharma of Sarika Goyal, failure of the nation state due to pre-colonial ties. What can populace do then, sir?
What can who do?
Populace.
I mean, technically, I don't have an answer to that, right? But what do I try to teach? Constantly look at myself and ask myself, what's my place in the world, right? How is it determined? And what can I do to unlearn my own privilege and do something for others, right? That is what, you don't have to come to America to learn. Our cultures, I don't care where in India are you from or Pakistan. That it was and still is a huge part of our culture, care of others, right? Care of the weak, care of the poor. And secondly, I mean, to become part of a larger community in your own local sense, community, who are trying to do something. Now, we all know that individually, we don't have the power to change things. I mean, our lives are so precarious, but if we come together, right? Work together to any cause that makes another person or another constituency's life better, right? That is a dent in the large machine of capital. The only time neoliberalism or globalization and the power structures in it wins is when we become silent and start seeking our own interest at the cost of others, right? Then we have become part of the machine, right? And capital will do that. So I think the ideal response would be, you know, people always look for huge things that they can accomplish. And I always tell my students, it's the little things in life that matter, which are within our control. You know, if you see someone distressed, reach out to them. If you see someone is being harassed, see if you can help them, right? Little things, just sometimes some people just basically need a smile and, you know, a pat on the back. So don't think in mega terms of what we can do. Then if you're a scholar, right, make yourself available, right? Now, here is what I do, right? If someone sends me a question through an email, I reply it. Every now and then I sit down and record a lecture or something about something that I know, I post it on YouTube. That technology allows me to share whatever little I know with people from all over the world. It's not much, it doesn't change the world, but at least every single day you wake up and ask yourself, have I done something that is more than for myself? So I think it's not a very convincing answer. I think that's what we all can do.
So we have another question. It is from Neha Kaushik, a YouTube viewer. Sir, am I audible?
Yes.
Yeah, the question is, how does privatization, liberalization, and globalization impact post-colonial literature? I repeat the question. How does privatization, liberalization, and globalization impact post-colonial literature?
What's the second part of the question?
It's about globalization, sir. Privatization, liberalization, and globalization. Mm-hmm. What is the impact of that in post-colonial literature?
Okay, good question. So, I mean, think of it, what drives privatization? There is a narrative behind it, right? The narrative is that government is corrupt or government is wasteful and private enterprises can do things better, right? So, hence, what, let's say Indian Railways or Pakistan Railways, Pakistan Railways employs 80,000 people, right? A Japanese company comes in and says, if you privatize it, we can run it with 400 people. The trains will be on time. We will modernize your equipment. That's a wonderful idea, right? But in post-colonial studies, when you look at beyond the economism of it, what you are trying to tell Pakistan then is, look, you already have so many problems all over your country. There is a group rising in KPK. There is another group rising in Balochistan. All of these people are rising against the state because the state has not been able to create enough social debt to purchase their loyalties. How does the state purchase your loyalty? You know, not simply by accident of birth. The state purchases your loyalty by saying, if you are a law-abiding citizen, we will make sure that you're taken care of, you'll get an education, you'll get good jobs, right? So by applying privatization to this institution called Pakistan Railway, 88,000 people would lose their jobs. These were previously the people whose loyalties were aligned with the state because their lives depended on the job. Now they have suddenly become more recruits for anyone in the private sphere who wants to say, you have a grievance against your government, come with us and we'll tell you how you can get back at them. So what does the privatization do? It does make systems efficient, right? But it also then creates huge constituencies of people who cannot afford to be there. Think of education, right? If there is no state provided school system, you know, from elementary to 10th grade and 12th grade, and then there, if there are no universities that can incorporate colleges where poor people can go, if all of it is dependent on you being able to pay the fee, right? How many people will be able to get an education, right? And so in post-colonial studies, then when we look at literary texts, all it tells us is, okay, who is pushing what kind of politics in their novel and who does it enable, right? So you can look at a novel and see, okay, I just finished reading this one. This is about you know, how to get filthy rich in rising Asia, right? And you realize, okay, this is a critique of globalization in the system of economics. If you read The White Tiger, right? You suddenly then, when you apply this knowledge and knowledge of globalization, you realize that in so many developing economies, including India, the biggest problem is that the formal subsumption of labor has already happened. Labor is already incorporated within the project of capital, right? But the real subsumption of labor has not happened because the same workers who leave their villages and come and work in the cities in Chennai and everyone else are also connected to the social power structures of their villages, right? So you don't make them precarious simply by not making laws to protect them. They are also precarious because of their caste in their village. Right. So what does the main character in The White Tiger does, right? Kills his own master and starts his own business with that money. But the cost, why is he a white tiger? The cost, he already knows that when he runs away with his nephew, his entire family in the village would be killed, right? That is the precarity, the double precarity of this worker. So this knowledge of globalization and how the economy works, how labor is exploited, what makes them precarious in post-colonial studies, I think is an important topic. And it enables... So, that was
kind of,
sorry, it's like I'm having the connection problems, yeah. Okay, Dr. Dibakar, thank you so much for your question. All right. So any other questions?
So the next question is, from Sarika Goyal.
Yes, so please, go ahead.
Is post-colonial condition responsible for creation of a fifth world or fantastical realms in literature?
Okay, so what's the question? Well, I mean, think of it this way. What is the role of the fantastic? Otherwise, I mean, it depends on where you're going. If you're just reading pure fantasy, it's different. Science fiction, it's different. But what do we imagine in a fantasy, in any kind of fantasy that you read in any language, is an alternative world, right? Sometimes we imagine a dystopian world in which we are in the future and all the norms are dead. Or if it's a romantic fantastical novel, we are imagining a world in which there is no hunger, in which there is no poverty. All of it, as Foucault would famously tell you, right, is that we cannot, absolutely cannot access the future, right? Because the only language in which we can access it is the language of today. We have no access to the language of the future. So whatever we imagine in the world are our desires transported to another realm, right? But we carry with it the consciousness and its desires from now. In post-colonial literature, I mean, when we edited that volume on post-colonial, post-national fantasy, these are the issues that we grappled with. The texts that fantasize about an alternative reality and what's its place in post-colonial studies and what does it enable? I mean, my general idea is that post-nationalism itself is a fantasy. That's what I wrote in the introduction, because despite globalization and despite these claims of world coming together, you know, the world is still divided between those who have it and those who don't. The global economy of the North Atlantic region still depends on exploited labor. It needs that exploited labor. It needs corrupt leaders in Pakistan and Bangladesh and Africa to do the bidding of world powers, right? China. So even if we imagine a world, you know, what kind of a world would it be? What would it be? A liberal utopia? Would it be a Marxist utopia? Right? These are all the questions that you can put to on post-colonial fantasy or others.
Thank you, sir. And another viewer, Mr. Pranab, his question is, can we take the Kashmir novels like Half Mother and Tell Her Everything in post-colonial context? Sir?
Absolutely. Look, I mean, I don't want to step on anyone's toes, but anytime a constituency is under someone's control, right, that is a colonial situation. In case of India, Spivak 30 years ago had already theorized the concept of the fourth world, right? So the lives of Dalit people, the Adivasis, right, and Kashmiris, they all constitute a kind of colonial situation. How we got there is besides the point, right? I mean, the reason is that is a worthy subject of study, because there is a power dynamic. There is a population which is under control, right, under occupation. So absolutely, people have a right to study it as a colonial situation. And I think they should study it as a colonial, and they can use the same vocabularies from post-colonial studies. They just need to tweak them. There is a question here also. Is there a relationship between post-colonial? Absolutely, post-colonialism and gender studies? Yes. I mean, if you have read at least Chandra Mohanty's work, right? That was a revolutionary book, you know, under Western eyes, like Feminism Without Borders. Quite a few other scholars, there are queer theorists, there are theorists who study, you know, women's rights, right? So absolutely there is a connection. But postcolonialism is a very vast field of study and it's very eclectic. So you can pretty much fit anything that has to do with something liberal, radical, or more enabling.
So there's a question from Aparna Rajashekaran. Sir, can I continue? So you need to unmute yourself. Sir, am I audible? Do you hear me? Sir, can you hear me?
Yes, I can. That was by the established fields of study, the British lit people, the American lit people, the African American lit people who are in solidarity with us also felt threatened by us. Because one thing that postcolonial theory is good at is appropriating whatever knowledge there is available, right? We never really clearly define what we do, who we are, right? And that becomes a big problem if you're up with someone who has a clear idea of what a subfield of study ought to be. But what it enables us to do is to constantly keep renewing ourselves. In my own career, I started with your, you know, traditional reading Edward Said and Homi Bhabha and Gayatri Spivak and Robert Young, and then moved into Fanon, and then moved into Chandra Mohanty, and then Marxism, globalization. So whatever the paradigm, since one thing is clear in the field of postcolonial studies, and that is that our job is to criticize power. Our job is to be realist, to work towards something that challenges the powerful paradigms of religion, of politics, of economics. So for as long as we know that mission, right, we will constantly keep renewing ourselves with new knowledges and new theories. That's my, now in terms of its acceptance in US academy and elsewhere, well, there are resistances, right? People try to question whether or not what we do is serious scholarship or not. But we move on from there, right? And then we work in solidarity with gender studies people, African American, Latinx scholars. And so I still believe that it's a wonderful field of study and we can constantly renew it.
Sir, we have some more questions. Can we proceed? Sir? We have some more questions. Can we proceed further?
Okay, so I have another question. How much postcolonial gender studies is useful to better condition of women in the third world countries? Good question. I mean, okay, so what are theories for? I mean, theories by... So this was a question on in the...
Sir, can I go ahead with the next question?
Yes, please, go ahead.
Edward Said mentioned in Traveling Theories that when theories travel, they change and adapt themselves to the place they move to. Does globalization provide a first-hand experience or a modified one? This question is from Debashree.
So, yes, you know, as I said, what we critique is neoliberal globalization, right? Just like power in Foucault can be repressive, but is also productive. Globalization, on one hand, economically, it maintains the global inequalities. On the other hand, it makes possible for knowledge to be shared through technology, through travel, right? The question is to see that subtle difference as scholars and as practitioners, to not buy into this idea that this is one world and we all live in it and it's equal, to not buy into the romance of it, to see the subtlety and nuances of it. And yes, absolutely, things travel, theories travel from one part of the world to another. The local people, the local scholars nativize them, indigenize them. The only time our lives are impoverished are when we are trying to keep the outside knowledge out. My appeal is, my approach is always, I'm not a purist. So I'm saying, take whatever you got, if it works, use it, right? Let it change your own way of thinking so that you can build something new. The question is that in the neoliberal economic model, how much of innovation can you do? If a corporation comes into Chennai, my second to last book actually was printed in Chennai. So if they come in and tell you, here is what we want to do, this is how much we will pay you, here is the number of people we will hire, your government has already agreed to it. Now, what are the chances of you changing that? Is there a possibility? Because so much of it is already overdetermined before someone comes in. So then we have to figure out how to change things, how to change our lifestyles, right? So the question is knowing how so many things are overdetermined by the unequal power. But yes, I agree, theories travel.
So you need to unmute yourself.
Okay, any other questions?
Yes, sir, just one more. It's from Sharda Tripathi. How can post-colonial literature be related with Indian literature? How can post-colonial literature be related with Indian literature?
Okay, good. So, I mean, Indian literature is a huge concept, right? It's a huge generalization because, I mean, within India, you know, like there is Tamil literature, there is class-based literature, region-based literature. So in one way, if I am in the United States, right, for me, whichever regional literature I pick up, right, I can use it in a post-colonial literature class, but I will never make the mistake of saying here is Arundhati Roy's new novel and it can represent whole India, right? You never can do that. You have to be specific. Where is the novel placed? What does it do? Where is the author coming from? But here, yes, absolutely. We use, you know, almost all the major earlier Indian novelists, but contemporary as well, right? But how can it be within your own context? I mean, I think a regional novel, right, which deals with your local issues in a post-colonial literature class or an Indian, I saw that on your college list, you know, there is an Indian literature, I think, program as well. You can include them because then the students get a chance to experience their own culture as it is artistically rendered, right? And then they can bring their lived experience to it, right? So overall, if you look at post-colonial theory and what we teach in American classrooms, in North American classrooms, without Indian contribution in theory, diasporic and others, right? Or without Indian literary contribution, you will lose more than half of post-colonial studies, right? if you ever look at a PhD reading list on theory, I mean, we have to go through our Partha Chatterjee, Asish Nandi, you know, and all the subaltern studies people, right? And then people who are here, diasporic, majority of them are Indian scholars, right? So similarly, Indian literature is a major part of the post-colonial counter canon, right? And within that, you have to be specific. Where does the novel come from? Who's writing it? Whose lives? Because India is a complex culture. You know, it is one of the most complex democracies in the world, right? So you can't just study it with a broad brush. I mean, I don't need to tell you that you live there. So,
thank you, sir. It was indeed really nice to listen to you.
Those of you on YouTube, okay, I am also on YouTube, so look for Postcolonial Space so that we can stay in touch.
It's almost midnight there in your part, and you have been patient enough in answering all the questions. Thank you. Thank you so much, sir.
It's getting really late over here. So.
Thank you, sir. The session was very interesting, and I hope all would have benefited from this session. Now, I invite Mr. Prem, Assistant Professor, to present the vote of thanks. Over to you, sir.
Okay. Thank you so much. And yeah, as always, feel free to contact me if I can be of any help to any one of your students or you all.
Good afternoon. I offer my greetings to everyone who made themselves present online and also to our guest of the hour, Dr. Masood Raja, sir. To quote the great Victorian poet Robert Browning, but a man's reach should exceed his grasp, is true till this day in the sense that humanity serves to be accommodated with this unique attribute that is not shared by any other species. It can be defined as an ability to develop fortitude. It can be defined as a capacity to survive. And it can very well be defined as the propensity to progress. The times have barricaded us from pursuing and spreading education due to the pandemic we are doomed with now. But this has forced us, compelled us to adapt and evolve. The medium of online education is the next stage of development from the blackboard, to which we too shall rise. Today, what has taken place is purely a session of enlightenment. Dr. Masood Raja, sir, this is nothing short of your reputation that precedes you. Indeed, we are in great amazement and wonder for being a part of this event with you. In light of the moment I am bestowed with now, I would like to use this opportunity to give my appreciation and express my gratitude to the people who have made this day a much brighter one. First and foremost, Dr. Masood Raja, sir, being a man of high caliber, having a legacy of his own in the great tradition of literature, is in fact a very simple man, humble to the very core. The conversations I had with him led me to believe that great people let their actions rather than words to speak for themselves. This day, in truth of the collaboration Dr. Masood Raja, sir, has offered us, is a testament to the true spirit of human goodness. All of us know that the machinery of the world does not run without the fuel of money and fame. It has to be put forth now, as true as the sun and as true as the sea, that neither Dr. Mukesh Parikh nor Dr. Masood Raja expected anything in return for their humble service. They agreed to my request without a second thought, yet having no expectation of monetary gain. This is rare. This is not often seen today. Here we witness two humane individuals who have dedicated their lives to the endeavor of spreading knowledge. Dr. Pariksha was very flexible with his dates and has even promised to work with us further in our never-ending journey of decoding literature and theory. In my humblest opinion, I know my words fail, and they fail tremendously in expressing my gratitude to Dr. Masood Raja, who gave his word to be here to someone so far away on the other side of the world, literally to a nobody like me. And just helps me realize that the literature that we speak, we breathe, and we live for can connect even this diverse world of us. In that way, I also pay my heartfelt thanks to Dr. Mukesh Pariksha, sir, who also graced the event yesterday. I thank our president, Mr. P. Ilango, and our secretary, Mr. Rajendran, who authorized our project and provided the needed facilities to our team. I now thank our principal, Dr. D. Nagarajan, and our director of the self-financing wing, Dr. A.M. Tony Melvin, for supporting us by taking all measures necessary to host such a monumental webinar. I thank Mrs. M. Shyamala, head of the Department of English, self-financing wing of Kamaraj College, for her acceptance and support, as well as her guidance of our team. I thank Mr. P. Saravanan, the superintendent, to whom our webinar is most indebted to. It is only through his efforts and direction that we are able to stay connected even in this state of social distancing. Mrs. P. A. Andal of the Department of Computer Science in the self-financing wing of Kamaraj College needs special commendation and mention at this juncture, as the whole project rested on her thorough coordination of our online portal. I cannot express how grateful I am to my friend, Mr. T. Jayashanmugha Kumar. Tala, I think this is the best moment to tell that I thank you for being a part of our beautiful journey and playing a key role to guide us on the technical side. From the bottom of my heart, I offer nothing but my appreciation of the pristine kind of thanks and gratitude to my fellow staff members, those who have involved themselves to make the team and to make this webinar a much successful one. And I thank the participants on Zoom and our audience in YouTube for your love and criticism, for your comments and your feedback, and most of all, your overwhelming support. And last but not the least, I would like to use this particular juncture to thank my friend and my mentor, Dr. P. Sashikala, for always being with me in this team and in this effort to organize webinars. And without her, this webinar would not have been a possibility. And that is, in fact, the truth. We are in a marathon to pursue and to bring forth more occasions where the spirit of literature shall connect us together. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.